right. It was recorded. So let's officially begin our Lynnwood City Council work session for this evening, Monday, April 16th, 2018. Council members, do you have any questions or comments on any of the memo items? Yes, Councilmember Cotton.
I just want to state that the staff did an excellent job answering my question, so thank you.
Thank you. All right. Where is Mr. Lynn? I mean, Bill. Well, we're almost ready to move on to item B. Oh, here comes David.
We're close to moving on to item B.
I need it closer, I guess. Okay. Are you joining us at the table, Mr. Mock? Okay, we're ready. So we're moving on to item B. This is a briefing on Lynnwood City Hall campus lighting that we've been waiting for. Is Bill joining you? Or yes,
here's Bill. Bill's right behind me. Sorry, okay. Council.
So David Mock is presenting along with Bill Franz. Welcome.
Sorry to keep you waiting. Bill Franz here. And so Public Works has been doing some work over the last couple of years in response to concerns that we've heard about safety in our parking lots, mostly at night. And we've endeavored to improve things as we always do as engineers, at a reasonable cost, trying to do as much as possible without having to spend too much. And so we've worked with parks, and we've limbed up trees, and we've reduced bushes. We've changed out lights to brighter lights. We've added a new light on the front of the building. We put up some camera systems that show people when they're leaving the back door, they can look at the where they're going on a screen to see if there's anybody lurking or anything. And we were hopeful that doing that kind of work would solve the problem. Well, it hasn't. We still have our hearing concerns. And so we've wanted to share with you some of our kind of initial thoughts as we've done some kind of preliminary work on what next steps would be to go to that next step to improve safety. And so David's going to walk you through these kind of options. And what we kind of hope to hear from you tonight is you're on the right track, kind of go down this path, and we'll see where we land on which option. But David will talk more about that.
Thanks, Bill. So specifically, we're just talking about the lighting in front of City Hall between City Hall and 44th, and also we also looking at around the library as well. The lighting in those areas were constructed about 46 years ago, so they're getting quite old now. If you look at the back of the handout I gave you, there's a few pictures. The top right or left shows how one of them is getting taken over by a tree. Another one where we've added some supplemental lighting to help add a little bit more lighting right in front of the senior center. The bottom right, that one is actually interesting. If you pop the plates off these bottom brackets, they show the bolt patterns, and you'll notice that one of the bolts is missing. They're quite corroded, and so that was kind of, we want to kind of give you that this is kind of the condition of what's out there right now. And, you know, there's a slew of options of what we could do to improve the lighting out there. These existing fixtures, they're that bulb shape, and so it sends light upward and downward. So it doesn't really give you light exactly where you want it, which is kind of downward, so it kind of spreads it out all over the place. So they do have other kinds of fixtures that can be purchased to replace those that send it downward. But in order to do that, then we also have to make sure that the wiring and everything and the fuse panel is all can accommodate that kind of a fixture. So that's kind of where our concern is with the existing system, that if we were to do a retrofit, which is a possibility, we would want to hire a firm to go out and look at the electrical panel, also maybe do a few test pits to dig down and find the conduit, find out if it's corroded. It's, if possible, it's steel conduit. It could be full of water. The wiring that's going through there over almost 50 years is probably pretty degraded by now. So
we've even heard that there may not be conduit. They might have direct buried wire also. So we have to verify that
too. So it's a possibility that if we could, if we've determined that we could use the existing conduits and fuse panels, then we have here a rough estimate. It's a very high level at this point of around $26,000 just to replace the old bulb heads with the newer, more maybe we can go with some different architectural styles. There's a lot of them available. We could bounce off of the council or however we want to decide that. That they're LED and they would shine downward more, definitely provide a lot more light. We could also in the very back by 44th, there are no light fixtures back there right now. And so we could add about 12 more to better light that back side of the parking lot. And that would bring the cost up to about $60,000. So those are kind of some ideas for the retrofit. If it's determined that we can't use the existing conduits and fuse panels and such, we could go to a full new system, which if just for the City Hall area would be about $130,000. And if we were to include the library as well, the estimates are up to around $300,000 to do both of those areas. What we're recommending as a first step would be, well, one option would be let's not even think about retrofit and let's just go to a whole new system. If we do decide to do a retrofit, we'd recommend to go out and do an assessment of what's out there to see if it's even possible to retrofit it. So I guess there's three options, a do nothing, retrofit, or we could just go to a whole new system. And so we wanted to get your feedback as to what your thoughts were about that. And Bill, is there anything else that you wanted to add to that?
Vice President Sessions?
Thank you. This is one of my favorite topics. Thank you so much for bringing it to us and these details. On your options 1, 2, and 3 so far, the 130, right, full redesign, design materials construction, does that include the replacement of the fuse system and electrical boxes needed?
At a very high level, it does. And that number is pretty rough, though. So it could go up, it could go down at this point, based on what we had to work off of right now. That's our current estimate. It includes all that.
Okay. And then the $300,000 estimated would include the library and these with the extra 12 plus the replacement of the, assuming that we have to replace the system,
that's
too.
Right.
Well, you say extra 12. It would be a redesign, putting lights where they need to go, so it wouldn't necessarily be 22 and 12. It'd be a new design scheme that would cover the area.
It would also allow us to go to possibly a little bit taller poles, too. The taller pole allows the light to disperse a little bit farther, so we wouldn't be restricted to the short poles that we have right now.
But we would be trying to work around the trees best as we can. And, you know, so the whole issue of trees and what trees we retain and so forth would come into the design.
And I forgot to mention, but I should have also mentioned, too, that there is some landscaping out there that tends to create some blind spots and some shadow areas. Mm-hmm. And so if we were to do the lighting, we would recommend to look at some of those areas, possibly either remove some of that and replace it with smaller growing shrubs or that type of thing. And also maybe ADA upgrades, too. So there's this could be simple as a little lighting project to maybe more of an update to our parking facility.
Sure. And is that included in the 130?
No. Not the ADA ramps or the landscaping is probably more minimal, but that was not included in the price.
And when you say retrofit, what do you mean? Because you're saying retrofit, but we could still make them taller and things.
There's different retrofits. That's correct. One retrofit would be just to replace the bulb inside of the big, the round glass bulb. Another would be to pop the whole glass bulb off and put a whole new fixture head on top of the existing poles. Or another would be to take the pole out completely, reuse the foundation base, put a taller pole in. Anytime retrofit's involved, you don't know what you're going to get. Like I showed with the bolts on the You know, it's possible as soon as they start trying to unwrench those, they could snap that bolt right off, and then we're going to have to either rip out those foundations or somehow drill into them, put a new bolt in there.
Okay, and so do you have any estimation at all on a cost of a whole new system?
Well, that's what this, the 130 would be for City Hall, and then 300,000 would be for both the City Hall and the library.
Oh, I thought you meant 130 to do all the retrofitting plus. So, okay.
Yeah, so it's almost, you see where we're going with this.
Well, actually, I'm pleasantly surprised. That's really not a lot of money. I mean, for what I was imagining. I mean, obviously it's a lot of money, but this is so important and such a liability, I think, and such a problem. And again, it's 46 years old, and it's a problem. And I think we're going to have to do even more than that. Like with the curbs are so low, we trip on. I mean, there's so many things, like you mentioned. Mm-hmm. I think we will need a whole new system. That's my opinion. But if it's 130, I know that's estimated. That's still far away less than I imagined. So I'm excited about that.
And from
possibility.
From the NAB on up, those were redone with the rec center not so long ago. And as you know, we're looking at a potential new parking lot over in the corner, which if done, would be done with, you know, newer standards and so forth. So I think it really is from the NAB southward.
Sure.
It really needs to be done.
Oh, that's what I imagine too. Yeah. Okay, I'm pleasantly surprised. This is really important to me, as you know. I know to more than just me, but I'll just speak for myself. And I would really be in favor of looking more into a whole new system and just not messing around and wasting any money on things that might be breaking anyway and we'd have to replace anyway in the future, not far future and all that. Thank you for doing this.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. Thank you both for bringing this forward. I know that it's been on the mind of several of us on council on different occasions. As part of your investigation, do we know what kind of wiring's out there? Is it?
You know, I don't know specifically. I had one of our civil engineers look at it, working with also Johnny Dunn and our facilities group. So specifically what wire, I'm not positive. They did pull out the old as-built files, and they did date back to 46 years ago. And they were trying to figure out whether they actually even had conduit or not. So the records are not extremely clear as to what's out there. So if we were to do a retrofit, we would want to verify all that.
Okay.
I think Johnny thought that when he'd done some digging around out there, he'd not found conduit. He was going on some membrane too, so that's why I'm concerned.
Because that might also mean it's asbestos jacketed, or there's a bunch of different.
Right.
Yeah.
Older wire. Older wire.
Yeah.
So okay. Well, just a couple of things that you know, if we're gonna do this, I like the idea of reusing as much as we can, but you know. We're talking about kind of a home renovation project, and as soon as you open up the walls, you never know what you're going to find. So,
exactly.
I have a complete understanding that you might come back to us and say, "Hey, we we found some stuff." But probably some very obvious things, but I'll just state them. Whatever we do here, we want to make sure that we're communicating with so the campus continues to have that same look. So if we do go with some new heads, just make sure that we're holding in our minds that that'll be what the new parking lot has and whatever the rec center. And then the other thing is have we reached out to, and I don't even know if this is part of the lease agreement with the Snow Owl Library or if we still retain ownership of that building.
We do.
Okay. So in that case, we can't. Well, maybe it never hurts to ask.
We want to coordinate with them.
Yeah,
of course.
You could always ask and say, "Hey, we're going to do this really great upgrade to your building." So, anyway, it's our building, but you're using it, right? Yeah. So, looking for those partnerships. That's, I think, all I had. But thanks for bringing it forward, and I look forward to hearing more about it.
Councilmember Ross,
as the other vocal advocate for this, I appreciate you coming forward. I think I really do not. This is not just a safety issue. This is a liability issue for the city, and we really do need to do this and do it right. So I you know, I don't like the whole duct tape and baling wire approach. I've done it all my life, and I know it usually doesn't work very well. So I would, we can find a way. I think we can find a way to do the whole thing. I don't think there's going to be any way around that from what we've seen in the past.
Councilmember Hurst.
Let's see. How tall are the poles?
Are they 10?
I think they range in height. They're not all the same. And I believe they are at least 10, and some are taller than that.
Do you know how far apart they're spaced?
I don't. We have a plan that shows all the where they all are located, and we've done some initial assessment with cast, how far it casts and what areas they cover and what the overlap is on each one of those. Mm-hmm. So whether we do a redesign, I mean a retrofit or a full new one, we would go through it and look at how far it casts out and overlaps.
Okay. So the 130,000 option, is that are we installing those, or are you thinking a contractor?
No, that would be a contractor. Yeah.
That's pretty cheap.
We had a few different estimates on that. Yeah.
And then I assume that these will be dark sky compliant.
It depends on the fixture head that you choose. You can even put kind of blocks so it'll shine in the neighborhoods. It just shines where you want it to.
Because I think by code, if we're going to do the parking lot, we've got to
It has to comply with the city code, too.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Councilmember Frizzell.
In all my years in Lynnwood, I've always thought City Hall was poorly lighted. It always seemed like such a dark, dank place. And I think even with limbing up the trees, that's only solved a portion of that visibility issue. And I'm like these two gals. I don't want to be here after dark. I don't know what's going on. I own a home that is older than I am, which is more than 46. And I know every time we try to do something, we do find something else. So I would be interested in seeing what the full meal deal could cost us. You know, of course, staying as budget friendly as possible, but we do need to lighten up the neighborhood.
Mr. President.
Thank you. I think a lot of that goes to some of the things that we're working on for budgeting for outcomes, and part of that being to be a safe and welcoming city. I mean, safe, you know, is what we've talked about, but also welcoming. If it looks dark and dreary, that's not welcoming. But, you know, when you have, I mean, we're not talking Gotham City here. We're looking at lighting the place up and making it inviting. So I think that would also be a big part of it, is kind of putting a place in citizens' minds as this is where City Hall is. It's lit up. You can see. It's safe. It's welcoming. And, you know, that goes right along with what we've been trying to do as council. So.
Any more feedback?
I just want to mention that you're right. What you said. And about thinking you have it fixed when you take it down, you know, the walls and so forth, and you find you have to do a lot more. I'm right in the midst of doing that myself in my home, and I'm telling you it's something else. But anyway, it's also a learning experience, and I do agree that we really do need to brighten this campus up.
Sounds like you got your marching orders.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we suspected that we would migrate from 1 to 3, even without your input, as we go out and start doing what we're doing. But we did want to bring you a range of options just to see where your feelings were. So we've heard clearly. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now
we can move on to item C. This is Council's discussion on the 2019-2020 budget priorities. And Council President would like to kick off the discussion. Corbett Locke is joining us at the table to field any questions with answers. Council President?
Thank you. The main reason that I wanted to do this tonight is to start off our budget season as a council to get ideas of what it is that we're looking to do. We've heard from the administration and the plans that the administration has, you know, the five major goals, the five things that the city is looking to have the budget go toward. So I guess what I'm looking for, and I think it would behoove all of us, is one, to get the questions out about what it is that council is looking for, what priorities are on our mind, so that as the directors continue to discuss their budgets, they have an idea of what it is that the council is looking for and what the priorities of the council are coming up through this year. Second, I wanted to make sure that we get started on this early so that it doesn't come to September, October, where we're telling the directors, that's not what we're looking for, or the directors are like, that's not what we thought was going on, right? So it's to continue an open dialogue about what it is that the council is looking for and how we can merge what it is that we're doing, what it is that the administration's doing together to make it really what it is that we are doing to help the city progress. So with that, there are two policy questions that I put, and I did not articulate them well at all, but it goes something like this. One, the first one is, okay, how does the council want to decide what are our priorities for 2019-2020? And when I say that, I mean, well, we all have different ideas, you know, of things that we want to see, that we want to do, things that are important to us. So how are we going to, as a council, bring those into one bunch to say, you know, this is what the council wants to see happen in Lynnwood with the budget this year, and take those things and meld those with what the administration is doing? And then secondly, looking at the budget as a whole, what are the big concerns that we have in regards to the projects that are coming up, or in regard to the projects that are coming up, the different departments, and the outcomes that we are searching for as a council and as a city as a whole? And I think I say that because if we're looking at budgeting for outcomes, we need to make sure that the first thing we have is what are the outcomes that we're searching for, right? We have ideas. The administration has brought forth, these are the things that we're searching for that the directors feel are the best things for the city and for their departments. And do we agree? Do we not agree? And on what scale do we agree or not agree? And how can we tailor that to help the directors see the vision that the council has, and then help us as a council better see what the vision of the directors is, if that makes sense. So with that, I welcome ideas, questions, comments. If Mr. Locke has anything that he wants to bring forward, aside from what we've already discussed, feel free to do that. If you have questions specifically for him, ask him if he doesn't know the answer. I know he can get it. So I now open it up to council. Councilmember Cott.
Thank you. So, and thank you kind of for the run into this. And thank you, too, for council leadership for proactively pursuing this. I think this is fantastic. I'm excited about this. When you talk about how does the council want to decide what our priorities are and how do we want to maybe capture those, the first thing that popped into my head as you were talking was kind of like an idea of like a resolution. I don't know if that has any, if that dog will hunt with anybody, but whatever we maybe try and condense into a document, maybe a resolution, because it sounds like, you know, that we would be resolving to do something. But that might be one way. So that was just kind of my opening thought as you were kind of talking and introducing the subject. So.
Okay, thank you. So when you say a budget and resolution, what do you have in mind? Like specific things that we're looking for, an appropriated amount? I mean, what kind of things just off the top of your head, do you?
Yeah. No, so just from like a policy level, like kind of what, you know, you kind of, you know, as you were kind of saying here, you know, what are the priorities from count, like how do we want to communicate and transmit to the administration and department heads that, you know, hey, you know, when you bring us back a budget, you know, we're really hoping to check off this list. I don't know that it's specific in dollar amounts or even outcomes, but I think it's more like policy level, like kind of something, not quite the strategic plan because that's way more in depth than I think we would anything we would create, but something like, you know, we do want XYZ, you know, we do want to do something about homelessness or the opioid crisis, you know, those kind of things, like we want to, I'm just thinking out loud here, so that's just kind of what I'm thinking, but I'm not thinking specifics. When I imagine that, I'm not, as much as it saddens me to say, it wouldn't have any charts or graphs in it, but I'm not thinking anything with a table or dollar quantities, but just more kind of concepts and ideas we want it, we want the budget to touch on.
Okay.
I like that approach. You know, I look at what we're trying to do, and I think we need to be very broad, and I think we need to make sure that our we're at the level we're supposed to be, which is 30,000 feet. I look at, you know, establishing or finding a way to do better youth outreach would be the kind of statement that I would want to make for the budget, not necessarily how what that looks like, but the fact that that's a priority, and we would like to see what might come of that discussion or that what kind of proposal the administration might make on something like that. So I think it's much easier to think in broad terms if you can kind of raise up what you're looking at as a priority and make it more of a 30,000-foot level statement of what you would like to see in the next couple of years. Maybe we can work that way to start.
So a question that I'd have to that point, if we have and this statement is not an either for or against that, but if we have a 30,000-foot view, right, of that, and we say youth outreach is something that we would really like to do, and Parks and Rec comes to us and they say, you know, here's our idea, but it's not something that we think would work. How do you entail, or how do you foresee that playing out? And I only ask that because if we are vague and the departments come back with something that they think fills that ambiguity, are we going to continue to have a back and forth about, you know, what that is until that gap is closed?
Well, I think it depends on the subject. I mean, in some things, I'm perfectly willing to let the professionals figure out how to do it. And I don't necessarily need to add my input to it. But I do think that's also possible. If I said youth outreach, I might be saying, okay, we want to look at this area. I'd like to see this happen. Maybe, you know, if we have any ideas at all, like something at the high school. I mean, who knows what that might look like. But if I have some ideas, I certainly would be willing to provide them. I don't know that I necessarily do. And I think that, again, it would depend on the subject. If it's the kind of subject that you have a lot of information on or you have a very strong opinion on, then I would say the more you have to say, the better. But if you don't, then, you know, you want to hear other people's ideas.
And so with that, if the departments were to come, you know, Parks and Rec comes and says, you know, we have this program, this is, you know, part of our strategic plan, this is what we're working toward, without those detailed specifics, how far are we expecting them to go into what it is that they're doing, how many people they're, you know, that kind of thing? And I ask this only, and not just directly at you,
right,
but in general, to see what kind of detail that we're looking for beyond what's already been provided for us. And I say that with caution because our job as policymakers is not necessarily to get down into those weeds, right? We definitely want to make sure that the policies that are set do not prohibit the activities that we want to be done, but it's also not a free range, go and do what you want.
Right.
And, you know, spend, or, you know, whatever, cut, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So how do we as a council come up with those to get the product that we're looking for from the administration?
Well, I think that's probably what, once we have an idea of what the goals are, we can drill down on how much we want. You know, basically the first question is this even doable? Or in what way is it doable? So.
Yes, please.
I think at a high level, I would hope that we could decide that we're not going to spend more than the revenues that come in. I mean, just that's what we should be doing. But I do think, you know, I wouldn't mind giving some suggestions on what I would like to see happen. One of my concerns, and I'm not sure how we address this, is that we are going to have, I think, a retirement bubble. And I think we're looking not only at our administrative staff, but we could have a big bubble happening in the police department. And if that happens, the amount of time it takes to get a police officer in a car, we really have to look at this. And I think our current situation is that we have a lot of police officers that could retire in the next 4 or 5 years, and a lot of them. And so how do we replace those? Or do we set policies where there's some incentives for those officers to continue and not retire? Because, some can retire fairly early, age-wise. You know, so do we set something for them? And I'm not sure how, I'm just throwing it out. But do we have incentives to retain people? And maybe we can stretch out that retirement bubble. I think for us, as far as trying to figure out what to do with the budget, I'm not sure when we're going to have a forecast for the revenue for the biennium. I don't know what the finance director has that.
You will have that in mid-May.
Okay. Yeah. So that'll be helpful to figure that out. Because, I think, some of the down and dirty things that I would like to be focused on is can't we start a sidewalk program? Bill, our Director Franz, talked about it, and I think it's important for a walkability city that we need to really think about it. And that's expensive. Going back to the police, we know we have we've added our the 4 FTE for corrections, and then the social worker is going to have to come out in the next biennium out of the budget, and so that's basically an add to the police department. But do we, again, with the idea of the bubble, do we start looking at trying to hire some more police folks to build that force up? I've run out of great ideas, but it's a challenge to figure this out, and I do appreciate that we're working on it right now. I really appreciate that you brought this forward. Thank you. Yes, please.
One way that I've attacked the concept of budgets is looking at past performance. We've got a wonderful 250-page document that tells us what our ideas were 2 years ago. It'd be nice if we could, and just thrown out ideas, just somehow evaluate how well did we put that money to use? What are the outcomes? As I read more about budgeting for outcomes, it needs to be measurable. In my world, we talk about accountability. Were those funds well managed, well spent? Did they give us a desired result? And once we can look at departments and projects and we go, okay, we want to continue this, or, we really could let that one go, then we start looking at future projects and go, okay, these are the new ideas. These are the new kids on the block that we want to make room for. And where can we plug those in? And I think another concept is working through our wonderful, valuable commissions, letting them know that they are part of this process, that each of those commissions have valued citizens that have wonderful ideas of how to change the city. And we've got, you know, diversity, equity, and inclusion. We've got human services. We've got the Arts Commission. Let's make sure that when we do this that we're hearing from each of those commissions in a concrete way. I talked with Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion this week, this past week, and just kind of set the tone. Hey, if there's things that aren't getting done that you want to see get done, now's the time that we start talking about it, putting it on paper, getting a dollar amount, and again, what do we want to see happen? Not just, oh, it'd be nice if. And just putting ideas out there. I know we're supposed to be at the 30,000-foot level, but we need to hear from people who aren't there so that we can put value to what their concepts and ideas are.
To the point, that reminded me that that was one thing I had been thinking about, is that I know we want to do some outreach for town hall type-ish things. But you're right, the commissions, here are committed volunteers, people who are interested in the city. So I'm wondering if it's possible, and it's great you've done it on your own, but I wonder if each commission could have an evening where the strategic plan is presented to them so they can have a full discussion just amongst themselves with maybe staff or even if a council member wants to lead it, but to give them an idea, these are the strategic ideas. Are you in sync with that? And it'd be a lot easier to do that than to try to gather people into a town hall, I think. I mean, our commission people meet, and we know where they are, and so we can get them and talk to them about this type of stuff. And they're interested. I mean, they know a lot more than that, our average citizen right now.
So a question that I'm going to throw out here is, as we talk about what it is that we're looking to do as a council, what are some of those desired results or the outcomes that we're looking for? And after a meeting last week, I asked over the course of this week to kind of throw around some of those things, some ideas that you have about where you see council going in the budget talks and looking at the budget. So what are the things that we as a council now see? And these, anything we bring up may very well change when we start talking to boards and commissions and have more citizen input about, this is some things that we're discussing are not as big of a priority as we may have thought after we've heard from, citizens or other groups. But right now, some of the things that we've heard very recently, what are some of those ideas, some of the outcomes that we're looking for in producing and approving the budget?
So just in some recent interactions with the business community, I'll say that I've heard not word one complaint about the cost of permits or fees.
Not one complaint.
About cost of permits or fees. The only feedback is I needed it yesterday. And so I think bolstering and supporting our permit center and continuing those continuous improvement activities that are happening over there is really what that community, at least the business owners that I've talked to, and I've just said, hey, I'm your local friendly council member, how's it going? And it's never been the cost of permits or fees, it's always the timeline. So I think that being a city with a lot of small businesses where, one lady was like, I you know, I had to take out a second HELOC on my house to get this business expansion done, and, you know, I'm cutting it close. You know, so these are people that you know, the timeline really matters. So that's one. The other one was just at a high level, at a policy level, in looking at our strategic plan and just what we were trying to implement here. You know, item number four, being a safe, welcoming, and livable city. There's been so much discussion in our region about people getting priced out of the region that I really think that however we approach that strategic bullet point, we have to be also talking about what role cost of government has in that discussion. I don't know how it fits in, because I'm just kind of, you know, thinking on my feet a little bit, and I, you know, it's going through it. I took down some notes. I don't know what the solution looks like, but I know that it has to be a component in there, because, you know, the Times ran an article like a month ago about just the number of, you know, retiring people that thought this was their forever home, and they're packing up and moving out, you know, much to their great dismay. So, you know, because people have community here, and, you know, we know from other discussions, one of the best, you know, contributors to health into long life is strong community connections. And so when you take somebody out of where they've built community because they can't afford to live there, we have an impact. So I think cost has to play into that. So I don't know how, but I know it's got to be there somehow.
When you say cost of government, do you have specifics of what kind of things that you're thinking of in that respect?
Yeah, I mean, I think about, you know, we're always trying to strike the perfect balance, and, you know, we're in the bandwidth, but we're never quite there, right? That's life. But I think definitely thinking about continuing to look at both ways to streamline our processes, but also look at ways of streamlining them in a way towards expanding programs to help out. I know that when we've talked about the utilities and some other things, we usually piggyback any programs we do on federal programs that essentially validate somebody is low income or somebody is a veteran, or there's usually, and then it does help streamline, but that also means we're subject to outside entities. And so I don't know if it's another Kaizen event, bringing some people, you know, some frontline staff that are working the counter, people that know the nuts and bolts of Munis. I don't know what that is, but funding something that would allow us to kind of have a little bit more manifest destiny when it comes to saying, how do we dial the knobs for all of our different populations? That's one. The other one is, I know that we have a significant amount of banked capacity in property tax. And so I think coming up with a way to make sure we're being conscientious of that, you know, I think it's been studied and mentioned numerous times about Washington's got the most regressive tax structure, you know, and wherever you fall on that, property tax is definitely a hard one when you're retired and you're on a fixed income and that number keeps going up, right? So thinking about ways of creating policy around that banked capacity so that we're making sure that we don't touch that, but only in certain situations or for certain reasons. So those are just a couple ideas.
I just wanted to hit on a couple of things that you talked about. And I think some of these issues are regional problems. I don't think that they are issues that we can affect on a smaller scale. I think that housing, opioid issues, homelessness, those are issues that we need to partner with other South County neighborhoods, South County cities, other organizations, because I have ideas of what that could look like, but to do it just within our our boundaries, I don't think, is an effective tool. I agree with you about the property taxes. At the same time, as I analyze my property taxes for the last 3 years, you know, the biggest factor has not been Lynnwood. You know, it has been everything else. So, yes, we need to make sure that we are doing well with the money that we are entrusted with. But as far as us being able to make a big alteration, we're not there. I've put all 3 years side by side, and Lynnwood doesn't have that large of an impact that what we do can scale it back enough for people. So there are systems in process with the county as to how to lower that for some people. But I agree. I didn't like having a 23% hit on my property taxes this year. Nobody in this room liked it. But I don't think it was a Lynnwood issue. You know, we bear some with the RFA and all of that, but really it's less than a couple hundred dollars in a year. So.
Just one other quick statement. We also need to make sure that we're not tying the hands of future councils if we put things in writing and in resolutions. We want to make sure that if we create a policy, it's not something that we're taking away from someone in the future. So that's always a caution as well.
Again, I agree with Councilmember Frizzell about the homelessness, opioid thing being regional. I see that the Edmonds City Council committed $500 million to homelessness. And I thought to myself, well, heck, we need to talk, because they don't stop at the border, and that we need to work together. And, do we think about something like that? That's an issue that, man, it's tough. That's a tough issue to figure out. Are we throwing money at something? Are we giving money to organizations that just gather data and don't have impact? I think Seattle found that really you got to look at people that do the results, not the data collectors, I do think, we need to be cognizant when we're talking about taxes of what's going on. I mean, the county council, they chose, because they knew what was happening with state property tax, they chose to not do a property tax increase, And so even though, yes, the big hit is schools and it's state, our friends at ST, we just need to be aware that, yes, I just try to be all our friends. They're coming our way, If they build it, they will come. But I do also, Councilmember Cotton reminded me that I really would like to put an emphasis on the permitting. If they need more people, and I know people are hard to find right now, and we can't even find consultants, but we've got to do something to help them, because I look back at that survey they showed us, and, man, if in private industry, if 20 or 25% of the people said they thought we did a poor job, a company did a poor job, there'd be heads rolling, And I know they're up against a lot of stuff, and I'm not saying that we should be rolling heads, but I'm just saying we need to help them. And I think that's a priority that somehow we got to figure out how can we do that. So I have no solutions, but I have all kinds of ideas to throw out there and problems, But, and maybe into the weeds, but I've heard recently that some really positive stuff as far as the impact of community safety division, the increase in officers and staff, that there were some people that were skeptical that that'd be, that maybe that was a waste of money. And they've turned around and they've said, it's really made a difference of what's going out there. They just need to have some resources to send people to as well. And if we can somehow affect that within our budget, that'd be great too.
I did, before it escaped my mind, I did want to close the loop with Councilmember Frizzell's comment about making sure that we get kind of a report back on previous programs we have funded. I think that that's a really good point, especially because we are budgeting for an outcome. So I think thank you for that reminder. So if we do, if some of the programs that are coming forward that were programs in our BFO light approach, making sure that we're getting that report back on, you know, we funded this program, these are the metrics we were going to measure it by, and this is how we did. So we, you know, it's a good idea for, or it's a good, I think, indicator for us to know, you know, what works, what doesn't, and, you know, if somebody wants to come forward with a better mousetrap, we're all for it, so.
So I'll also let you know, one of the things that I've asked the administration, and this is something that we're working through, kind of what Councilmember Cotton just mentioned, was a report on the programs and things that were done, and that one of the things that we're working out is, because the way that we're structuring the budget this time, or that the administration is structuring their, I guess, process of doing the budget, is different than the way they did, where they just say each department, you know, has this much and they can do this, and they have, you know, they're working on these specific priorities that they have. So depending on how the programs that have been implemented or they're looking to implement fall within those priorities will depend on whether or not they're actually brought to us. So with that in mind, it's not necessarily going to be an apples-to-apples comparison. And so we're working with the administration on how we can present that so that it's transparent and full, but also to show that this is the way we did it on the Budgeting for Outcomes Light. We're taking that budgeting process a step further, so it's not going to be the same thing. The programs may be the same. There will some that may be different, but I think it is important that we get, you know, what are the costs, what are the success measures, you know, of those programs to see, are those things that we do want to consider going forward in the budget. So just so you know, that's something that we're working on, trying to get how we can present that from the administration or from the past budgets to make sure that it's in line with what it is that the administration's priorities are currently, and the way that they're budgeting different than they did on BFO Lite. Is that an accurate statement?
If I can make a comment, I think we're at the point to where we no longer consider our process to be BFO Lite. We are now at the dilly-dilly, whatever that commercial says. We're at a little bit higher level. Not quite BFO heavy, but we are somewhere at a higher level. Dilly, dilly. Corbett, if you want to, since you're here for the.
Well, all of this is very useful and enlightening for us to know what's on the council's minds. In terms of us reporting to you what has been accomplished in this current budget, my suspicion is our list of accomplishments that we started last quarter with you, I think that is going to be more informative and illustrative than our reporting on our performance measures, just because that's still something that we're not great at. It's really difficult to measure a lot of the things that we do. And so it's going to be a good effort, but, you know, I don't think you're going to want to make every decision based upon the outcomes. And you shouldn't anyway, because they are one factor. And, for example, as mentioned here, if one division doesn't perform very well, does that mean that they should get more funding or less funding? So, you know, it's just it's a factor to consider. So we will try to couch it all to you in a way that is helpful for you in making your decisions. If I can just add on, what I'm hearing is not strong disagreement with these priorities and the strategies and the objectives that we have provided to you for your review. Sometimes it's easier to just react to something rather than come up with it on your own. And this was one effort for us to try to show you what's in our minds and our list of priorities. So far, I haven't heard you say any particular part of it is incorrect. So please let me know if I'm wrong in that. And then secondly, in looking at your list of topics of interest, I see a lot of these folding in really well, naturally right into our priorities. One example would be small business concerns, make it easier for small businesses to do business. Okay, that's item D. Well, our priority two is about making the city financially sustainable and economic growth for all. So that's an instance where I think we are exactly in alignment, and if there's some particular issue you want us to focus on, we can. Some of your list items are really discrete things to go and achieve, and we'll help you do that. Others are really very long-reaching and almost unachievable. So you have a mix here, but I would say by and large, most of the items here on your list, A through L, most of them do fit within, and you can help guide us as we bring our budget proposals to you if I'm characterizing your comments and sentiments correctly.
I thought that that was a lot of good stuff that was said. I really agree with just about everything that everybody has come up with, and love how it does align so well with the staff's priorities as well, folds together nicely. Just a clarification for me, Councilmember Hirsch, when you're talking about like being prepared for those who may retire in general, so would that be something that the different departments, wouldn't they already be kind of preparing for that? Irene, I'm just trying to remember. That isn't that part of their planning already anyway?
Yeah, it started with HR in, when they were in the summit. They did their presentation. They mentioned it. And I tried to get some specifics out of them. And they said, well, we don't know, you know, when people are going to retire. I think it's maybe a little more concrete with the police department as far as the numbers that are out there. But it's – I just don't want us to have a big hit of people leaving. And I don't know how, you know, besides locking the door, how to do that. And so that's why I'm throwing it out. You know, are there incentives we can give people to not retire?
I hear you. And in really, in our last biennium, if you remember, we actually did have extra retirements in the police department that weren't planned for. So that did happen to us, and we did have to adjust the something for that. But I just really, you know, like that what we're hearing is a lot of the same things that the staff has talked to us about, and that we've been talking about at the summit and at the leadership level. One thing I want to focus on differently instead of bringing a new idea up, because you guys did such a good job, is to – I also in this process this year, hopefully, we can focus on the good that's already been done. And I think sometimes if we focus on what has we did last in the last BFO process and what's come out of that, like what are the good things that have come out of that, that when we know what those things are, it's easier to find out what we still want. Because I still hear, even tonight, I hear people talking about some things like, I wish this. And I'm thinking to myself, we do that. We have done that. I mean, my memory is not very good either. But I want us to not hammer on things that we're already doing. And maybe we can help remind each other and keep us accountable on the things that we are doing. For example, outreach. The city has never done more outreach ever in the history of the city than it does now. For the budget, for events, for what good things we're doing. I mean, on and on and on. It's never done more, ever. And I've been following the city, whether from a newspaper editor or working at the city now, for 20 years. So it's never done more than now. And they're really taking advantage of all of the tech, high-tech things to be able to do that, including boards and commissions. We're doing that. At each of the different boards and commissions, we are asking those questions. We are including them. Yes, can we do more and better? Yes, of course. But I'm also at these boards and commissions, just like you, hearing them look at us like, well, yeah, that is a good idea. I mean, we need to maybe ask different questions, maybe more open-ended questions instead of a yes or no question. But we are doing that, and we did do that for even this budget. We just had, not long ago, the joint boards and commissions meeting with us there, or some of us were there, and that was wonderful and successful. But we already did it. I mean, we've done it, and we can do it again. I'm just saying, don't bring up that we need to do it when we are doing it, because then it makes us look bad. You know what I'm saying? Give us credit where credit's due. Having a strategic plan and priorities, we're doing that. We're doing that. That's great. And I think that it's proven with what we've said tonight that a lot of the stuff that we're talking about, the staff has been listening to us all along, at least since I've been here for going on the third year here. Communicating early about the budget, that's happening better than even the last time. The fact that we have the budget book now that we haven't had before, yay. The regional talks of homeless and, you know, like example of what Edmonds is doing and did. Well, if you think in your memory a little bit, we actually have some other things going on as well. You know, that maybe we can't talk about right here, but at the moment, but there are other things going on, and we know that. So we don't have to say we're not doing anything, because we know we are doing things that are coming up. The financial awards that our finance department has received. And I'm just saying these things matter today, because this has just happened since the last time we talked about the budget. So what can we do now that we have these things to move forward? You know what I mean? Where before we had to worry about getting these things and doing the extra outreach and getting the financial awards, getting the budget book, all those things that we were told, well, we got them now. So now what? The decision we made last time on changing the amount of savings for the rainy day fund and stuff, that we made that decision as a whole. We didn't all necessarily agree, but that was a decision we all made. Again, not everybody was happy about that, but we made that decision together. And I just want to move forward with giving each other and the staff and ourselves more benefit of doubt, grace, and being realistic and kind of remembering what we did. Because, you know, what I've talked about before, too, and what we talked about at the summit, I don't want any of you to turn around on any of us later, whether it's campaign season or not, to say, you don't think this or that, but you are part of this team and you also made these decisions. And if you can't tell us what those problems are now, then you, in my book, you don't get to bring it up later, you know. But also something else, just to finish. I mean, there's so many things. These are just things off the top of my head right now. The utility taxes, the property tax, like you mentioned. We, the city, has given all the discounts, made the different special discounts for different groups in our city for utility and property taxes. And so we've done those things. And we'll continue to do it. And I'm just saying, give credit where credit's due. we are doing those things. Maybe what we talk about is what we want to still do too, you know. So just moving forward, I just hope that we give each other grace and try to remind each other, keep each other accountable on the things that we have already done, because, like, I forget too. But reminding us so when we bring it up, we can give ourselves, not just us credit, but the city as a whole. And thank you for this talk tonight. And Corbett, thank you for bringing the details to us.
You're welcome.
Guess we've forgotten.
We had two captains tonight. One thought I had, Carbo, when you were talking, because I realized as you were speaking it, the 500-some-odd page book of the budget book that we got last year done for our budgeting for Outcomes Light, I'm imagining getting some kind of report out from those programs is probably an immense staff ask. As I'm thinking about it, if that was my job, that would be a lot of work. Just a thought, I'll just throw it out there, especially given that what we've heard tonight, that we're doing things a little bit differently because we're learning. We're on kind of that steep learning curve with the budgeting for outcomes. I would be okay, and I'm only speaking for me, but I would be okay with having the report out of the previous budget outcomes after we create this budget. And I think it would be kind of just a good anecdotal, you know, educational piece. But as I'm thinking about all that we're asking from staff to put together a budget for light dilly dilly or a budget for outcomes dilly dilly, that then also asking for a report out of the previous outcomes might be a heavy lift indeed. So I would be okay with. I do still think it's valuable to hear what our outcomes were, but I'd be okay with. Especially because it sounds like a lot of the programs are changing and a lot of what we're going to be presenting or moving forward for this next budget cycle is different. I'd be okay with that being something we kind of receive anecdotally after the budget's created. One thing too, Corbett, just as you were talking about, and thank you too for the strategic plan is well done. Bring back my thanks to all the other support that helped with this. The one thing I did want to make sure that I think for me is a little bit of an emphasis, and I'm only speaking for me, is just the priorities we're looking at, the 18 through 22. I think that there really has to be some kind of cost component associated with the livability of the city. And I think that's just timely given the climate we're in. This region is a little bonkers right now with housing and cost pressures. So I think that we, and you know, it might be that, you know, to Councilmember Ross's comment, you know, about not tying future hands, it might be that the next biennial budget, that's not an issue anymore and it comes out. But I think that for this budget, we need to just associate some kind of livability cost element in there. And then lastly, Councilmember Hurst, as you were talking about the police department and kind of this retiree bubble, it made me remember annexations. And how are we preparing for that? Because I know that that's a front-loaded effort. Because, right, if we're going to provide services for twice the size of a city that we currently have, we have to be able to roll those services on day one, even though we don't necessarily receive the tax income until many months later. So I don't know what that looks like as a budgeting for outcomes outcome, or it looks like as a element in our strategic plan, but I think it's something we have to have in there somehow. I don't know if that's a separate fund that we think about pushing money into over the next several years that says, you know, this is our annexation prep fund, and, you know, when we know we're ready to do it, we know that we're going to hire X number of officers and permitting and code enforcement and et cetera, to support. I don't know what that looks like, nuts and bolts, but at a 30,000-foot view. So
Any other comments or questions on this particular topic?
Yeah, I just would like to say that, so this is the beginning of a discussion. I want it to be clear that, you know, this will continue and, you know, not that, oh, we had this one talk and these were your priorities and here you are. No, that this will, you know, we'll just, we want to keep this an open discussion. And Corbett, I haven't, to be honest, tonight I was focusing on, you know, what I was hoping to have as far as priority. So I will critique the strategic plan and let you know.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So one of the things that I'm working on that I'll work with council leadership and administration is throughout this budget season, having setting time, maybe each work session or each Monday work session, where we have some time devoted to a discussion like this. That way, as ideas come up, concerns come up, that we can bring those forward almost as a placeholder on the agenda each work session, so that we have some time available where we can open up the discussion like this. Because I think, you know, sure, talking about it, we get some ideas, we get some thought, but as we move along through the budget process, as the administration talks to us more about what they're doing, as we talk with each other more about what we're doing, as we hear more from citizens, there will be more ideas that come up and pop out, activities that we want to engage in, that we are engaging in. You know, we'll come to the forefront, and as we keep this kind of an open dialogue and continuing on, you know, tabling it till the next meeting and that kind of thing, continue on with the discussion. What I'm hoping is that we don't see this as these are things we're doing, these are things we're not doing, and we need to change that. What I'm hoping is that this becomes a discussion to where we say, this is what the priorities of the council are. This is what the priorities of the city are. How are we going to accomplish those? And that's what I'm hoping these conversations will evolve into, to a point where we have very specific priorities, not necessarily drilled and nailed down, but something that we, you know, in order to have a goal or anything that's measurable, you need to at least have what that goal is going to be, right? So for our priorities, what do we want the resolution of the budget to be? When it ends up, you know, we have set, as Councilmember Cotton's mentioned, if we have a budget resolution, what are those things in that resolution that we as a council want to sign our names to and say, yes, this is what we would like and this is what the city is moving towards? And the more that we can do that with the administration's strategic plan, I think the more cohesive that whole thing will be, because we'll both have citizen input. We'll both have ideas coming from different perspectives, many different perspectives, to engage whomever throughout the city, whether it's the employees, whether it's the citizens, the council, you know, any of the elected officials, anything like that, as we continue that dialogue and the discussion in that order, I think we'll come to that end resolution that fits the city's bill, that the citizens are glad to see, that the council is happy with, that the directors say, this is something we can do. We can get behind this. We have ideas. The programs that we have envisioned, that we've heard from the citizens, all match what this budget is. And then we continue to do that and sharpen it throughout the biennials with future councils, you know, and not tying their hands in the priorities that we've set.
No, I just want to express my appreciation to Council President Gooden for having this on the agenda, and I like the idea of Council continuing this discussion over the next several weeks. We will have our budget kickoff on what day?
May 15th.
May 15th, we begin our formal budget kickoff. I found this conversation to be very, very helpful to me, as the mayor's office needs to provide direction to department directors as to how to craft their budget. So I appreciate the council's giving good direction tonight. I heard a lot of things tonight, which to me is good direction. I heard that we need to really watch our revenues and make sure that we're not blowing through our revenues. We need to make sure that, you know, we're exploring things at a 30,000, keeping in mind the things that you are looking at from a 30,000-foot level, just to make sure we're going in the right direction. Because for us, this is not just a two-year budget. It is part of a 10-year strategic planning process. So we just want to make sure that we are in alignment long-term for where the council wants to go. And these other issues, the homelessness and the opioid, and the suggestion of partnering, that's something, too, that the mayor has been talking to us quite a bit about leveraging resources, because we can't do it all. We just can't do it all. So I'm grateful that the council is having this discussion as we go into the budget process over the next several weeks and into the fall when we deliver to the council the mayor's preliminary proposed balanced budget at that point. I also want to thank Corbett and his boss, Finance Director Springer, who've been diligently guiding directors on how approaching the budget and going through all the mechanics. Corbett spent a lot of time developing this strategic plan over the past several months, and I think he's done a good job of capsulizing things in a fairly readable document. And also appreciate the council did not get into the weeds and tell us that you'd rather see us budget for gold paper clips instead of the silver paper clips. That's a level that we'd rather stay away from. So thank you so much.
So as Art was speaking there, one of the thoughts that came to my mind is, you know, as we have this 30,000-foot view that we have, right, as council, we're looking over this thing from a very high level. And I don't know much about flying and piloting, but one thing I do know is when you're just 1 degree off, right, over the course of that flight, you could be miles away from what your actual target is. And so as the reason I want to continue this discussion is because as we see that we may be veering that direction, you know, if we're off from what it is that our desired path is, as a council, we can bring that in and change that trajectory so that we're going to where it is that we actually want to end up, rather than having a conversation, as Councilmember Hurst said, now and having another one in September or October and find out that, you know, here's staff and we're thousands of miles the other direction or in opposite direction. So I hope as we do that we'll be encouraged to bring forth these ideas that we have, things that we hear from citizens. You know, and as Councilmember Sessions, Council Vice President Sessions said, those things that we're doing, those, I think they should be brought up as well. I mean, if you think that things are not being done, things that are being done, any of that, I think, is open game for us to discuss, because that's what will bring out what are the positive and or negative changes that have happened or that we've seen happen, and how can we turn all those into positive changes to continue to move this whole thing forward. And beyond just the budget process, the collaboration between the mayor's office, the council, and the citizens, you know, the boards and commissions, everyone involved, we all have a huge part in making sure that the budget is what we want it to be, and we want to make sure all those voices are heard.
I like Council President Goodwin's analogy of the 1% being off course, because I've been with the city going on 10 years, and we've spent a lot of time over the years getting to a point where we have a budgeting for outcome process, that we have a strategic plan that's based on that, that we have a community vision that's all somehow integrated. Because what it does for someone like me in the mayor's office is whenever we get an idea from whether it's from a department or from a board of commission or even from council, I look at that idea in the context of how does that relate and align with where we're trying to get to. And if it does, I say, well, let's look into it. If it doesn't, then I'm probably going to recommend that, you know, we not spend a lot of time on it because it's not relevant to where we're trying to get to. Because if we go that direction, we get off course that 1 degree. And so this provides a roadmap to keep me on track to make sure that we're providing the right guidance from the mayor's office in in terms of how we're getting from here to there.
So as we go through this, I guess an expectation that I would have from each of us is when you have ideas that are not brought up in our discussion, things that you're looking for, things that you think you need to have better ideas, make better decisions, let council leadership know what these things are. Doesn't mean that every one of them will get. I mean, you know, I know Councilmember Cotton asked and he realized if I make this ask for all these reports, that is going to be a heavy load. Coming into budget season, is that heavy load necessary at this time, right? And it sounds like he's kind of decided it is something that I want to see, but that's not a priority right now, right? And so as we do this, the council leadership, we will, in most instances, decide what the priorities are. So what I need from you then is to make sure if it's something that you feel is a great priority, let us know that. Rather than just sending us something, say, I feel that this is a priority and here's why. That way we can discuss that and bring it forth as a priority rather than an idea that is just going to be a lot of work for someone. And I think as we prioritize those as a council, we'll be more in line with what it is that we're trying to do and get to what are the council's priorities as a whole, if that makes sense. All right. Any other questions or comments? Okay. All right.
So I don't think we need a break. No executive session. I don't have any other comments except to ditto what Art was saying about being thankful for your conversation. And you have keys to our doors. Mm-hmm. Our phone lines work. Our email works most of the time. Our texting and our phones work. I want to make sure that you all have access to get the answers that you need. So use whatever resource you want to use if you have a question about something so that you come to this table as informed as possible.
So. Awesome.
Council President, any closing comments?
I don't think so. No, not often, no.
Vice President has a comment?
Yes, thank you. First, I want to introduce Jason in the audience. Sorry, Jason. He's from Edmonds Community College. He's here watching us for an English class at Edmonds Community College. Did we do okay? This is a regular work session, by the way. So every other, it's a business meeting. We're up there and we hear from the citizens and stuff, but just a reminder, Jason is working on something with the traffic and planning a paper, and that we have a lot of really smart people around here if you needed ideas and stuff to call and find out which staff member. I could help you with that too. Also, before we go, Council, I haven't heard from anybody who would like to be the lead for our Fair on 44th planning. It's a pretty low commitment. You don't have to necessarily be at all the planning committee meetings because even though we're very important, of course, but really we're not that important. So actually we're really not that important. So the first planning meeting is at 2 p.m. I believe it was May 23rd. Do you remember, Beth? I know it's on the wall. It's on the cupboard in there. But I would like to know, I was the lead for this for the last 2 years, and the first, and both times we did something when it came to dogs and pets and things like that. But really, you can come up with whatever you want. But somebody does need to take the lead. So who would like to do that? I put this out like weeks and weeks ago. So, yeah. Christine, you want to do it? Right on, Christine. Okay, that...
If I could interject, Councilmember Sessions was in charge last year, if I'm not mistaken, mm-hmm. Right? So you can ask her any of the stuff that you have to do, yeah, and she will have firsthand knowledge of what it took. So.
Yeah, and let's see, you will be in town still on May 23rd. However, I know you got your, anyway, we can talk about this offline, okay? But you don't have to be at every single meeting, but we'll talk more about that. Okay, and then a couple more things. We have volunteer recognition event tomorrow night. How many of you plan on going to that? Yes, you are, and I make a note of that. I'm sorry, Ruth, did you say you're going? Who's not going, I guess, and you can't come, other than I know you guys can't because of that. But the rest of us will be there? Yeah, I know. I'll make sure and do that too. Mm-hmm. No, this is not a this is not an official, or it's not a council meeting, yeah. Of any sort. We're not doing business. Us council members aren't doing business. It's a good idea for us not to eat at the same table, probably, though, which probably won't be too much of a problem. And also, we have a Lynnwood Chamber meetings are always really interesting, but it's going to be particularly interesting on Wednesday morning. We have Insurance and Finance Committee meeting on Thursday. And Friday, Step Up. I think just Christine and I are going to that. Anybody else? Okay. And that's it for me. Thanks, Council. Good conversation.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you. I think that Councilmember Frizzell should get a sash and a fancy hat for volunteering for that, for the booth. Sashes, I mean, got to be fancy. I did want to just note that Monday, the 21st of May, we've settled on the date as our next town hall. So I wanted that was emails today, so I thought I'd broadcast that to the world who's listening, as well as us here. So conversation with the council 2.0. Location TBD, not the Transportation Benefit District, but the to-be-determined TBD. Yes, I know there's acronyms abound. So that's it.
Council President?
Now I remember what I was going to remind us of. Wednesday, our work session, we're having a discussion about the Youth Commission, the ideas for the Youth Commission. We will have Jonathan and Kelly from the Parks and Rec Department. At least one of them, I think both of them will be here. One of the things they're going to do is discuss how the first night went at the open gym that they had on Thursday, as well as some of the ideas that they have come up with to engage youth. We will also have Megan Potter from Lynnwood High School will be joining us. She's a senior at Lynnwood High School. So she's going to share some of her thoughts and ideas about what she as a youth, you know, that would fall under this commission category is kind of looking for or the youth that are in her age bracket are looking for, and some of the ideas that she has with ways that we can engage with the youth. So one of the things that I would like us to focus on in the next few days as we come to this meeting, what is it that we as council can do to engage with youth rather than the expectation of them coming to our meetings? How can we go out and incorporate ourselves into what it is that they're doing? And I know Kelly and John have some ideas for us, so, you know, I'll have them also mention some of those things that they have for us to involve ourselves in, to just build that rapport with youth and hopefully, you know, start developing some of those trusting relationships where they will be willing to come to our meetings or to engage with us in different activities that we're looking for as well. So just kind of give that some thought over the next few days, and then we'll have that discussion on Wednesday. So that's that.
Anybody else? All right, move to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.